Shall we start? Shall I start my lecture?
No, sir. Good afternoon to all of you. I welcome you all again in the keynote session second, in which the second keynote lecture will be delivered by Professor Ashok Kumar Ganguly. Good afternoon, sir. And on behalf of my university, my department, I strongly welcome you here in the in this Indo-US webinar and lecture series. So in this session, Professor Ashok Kumar Ganguly will deliver the second keynote lecture. Professor Ganguly is presently holding the Institute Chair Professor, Deputy Director, Strategy and Planning, and Professor of Chemistry, as well as Professor of Material Science and Engineering at IIT Delhi. Professor Ganguly is also the founding director of Institute of Nanoscience and Technology, INST Mohali, from 2013 to 18. Professor Ganguly obtained his PhD degree from Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, in 1990 in the area of thallium-based high-temperature superconductors. He has been a visiting scientist at DuPont Company, United States, in 1990 to 91. And a postdoctoral associate and visiting scientist at Ames Laboratory, Iowa State University, USA, from 91 to 93 and then 2004 to 5, and at EPFL, Lausanne, 2010 and 16. His research areas of interest are in the nanomaterials, superconductors, complex metal oxides, and intermetallics. His group is actively involved in design of nanostructured materials with applications in water purification, hydrogen generation, photoelectrochemical studies, and superconducting materials. Professor Ganguly has published over 350 research papers, which have been cited approximately 8,500 times and has filed 5 patents. He has an H index of 46 and I10 index of 190. Professor Ganguly has completed successfully several research projects, including some with industries. He is the recipient of various national and international awards, such as National Award of Nanoscience and Nanotechnology given by DST Government of India, Silver Medal of the Chemical Research Society of India, MRSI Medal, CNR Rao CRSI National Award, Chemical Excellence Award by Indian Society of Chemists and Biologists, and the Professor CNR Rao Bangalore India Nano Award given by the Government of Karnataka. Professor Ganguly is a Fellow of Royal Society of Chemistry London, Indian Academy of Sciences, the National Academy of Sciences India, and the Asia Pacific Association of Materials. Professor Ganguly also serves as members in various national and international journals. So today, we are very fortunate that we have Professor Ashok Kumar Ganguly here, and he will speak on design of nanostructures for energy conversion and related applications. Sir, please.
Okay. Good afternoon, everybody. It's a great pleasure to speak to all of you in this Indo-US webinar and lecture series organized by Jamia Millia Islamia. It is on a very important area on functional materials, and I believe a very good start was given today by Professor D.D. Sharma. So today I will be speaking on design of nanostructures for energy conversion and related applications. Now, although, so the design of nanostructures, as you know, will involve a lot of synthesis and structure, and of course, then their properties, but I will restrict mostly to the ideas behind the design of the nanostructures and not go into detailed synthesis. So let me thank all my students whose work I will be presenting to some extent. There are many other students who have worked in this area of photoelectrochemistry and photocatalysis, but mainly I will be discussing the work of Sunita, a little bit about Devashri, and mostly about Kashinath and Preeti and Sandeep. So most of the work is of Sunita, Kashinath, Preeti and Sandeep, and some work of Anirban if I have time. And the funding over the years has been from institutions like DST, Nano Mission and DST CERB, CSIR, and of course our Nano research facility funded by the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. So my key research activities, of course, in photoelectrochemistry or photoelectrochemical applications is first is how to synthesize a certain nanomaterial with a certain shape or size, and of course how to control them. Another aspect is how do you understand the growth of nanostructures, why something forms a rod or why something forms a thin rod or a thick rod, and what are the factors which control the growth of these nanoparticles. And these involve certain techniques like ultra-fast spectroscopy, NMR, small angle X-ray scattering, small angle neutron scattering. But I'm not going to discuss those. But what I'm going to discuss today are the properties, mainly photoelectrochemical properties, which is part of this third section, which involves photocatalysis, water splitting, and electrocatalysis, involving hydrogen evolution and oxygen evolution. So as a primary slide for those who are not in this field, that light can be converted to fuel or electricity by several means. You know, plants convert light into food, that is glucose, and it uses the leaf through a process which all of you know is called photosynthesis, in which it uses up water and carbon dioxide and gives glucose and oxygen. The same thing you can do in the laboratory where you can use the techniques which the plant is doing, basically involving electron transfer processes. And in the plant, the electron, it's a four electron reaction, as you know. Now this same reaction, if you want to mimic in a laboratory, you can go the way chemists work. You have a cell, you have electrodes, you have electrolyte, and you can do water splitting and produce hydrogen at one electrode and oxygen at another electrode. Now, so what should be the electrodes is the main part of research. How do you improve the electrodes? How do you improve the efficiency of the oxygen being produced and the hydrogen being produced? If you split water and the oxygen and hydrogen are coming out from the two electrodes, then it is called a water splitting reaction. However, sometimes you only block one end. That means you are producing oxygen. Then the reaction will be called oxygen evolution reaction. If you produce only hydrogen, then it is a hydrogen evolution reaction. So you can have total splitting of water. At both electrodes, you are getting oxygen and hydrogen, or you can get only hydrogen at one electrode. In the other electrode, you get some other ions, not oxygen molecules. And so that kind of cell will be like producing a HER reaction, hydrogen evolution. So you can have overall water splitting, you can have hydrogen evolution, or you can have oxygen evolution. For each of them, you can have a catalyst. And the catalyst, as you can see here, is being shown as SC, which is a semiconductor. So this catalyst can work either without light, then it is just a chemical catalyst. It can work in the presence of light, then it is a photocatalyst. If it works in the presence of potential, that means in the absence of light, then it is called an electrocatalyst. But you have to apply a potential there. So there is a difference between a normal chemical catalyst, a photocatalyst, and a electrocatalyst. When you combine the electrocatalyst, that means you have something, a material in which you are applying a voltage, and you also apply light, then you have a photoelectrochemical reaction. That means you are applying both potential as well as light. This light, we try to mimic the sunlight, and this is done in the laboratory. We don't use the sunlight outside because the sunlight changes every day depending on the cloud cover and the atmosphere, the moisture in the air, etc. So you use in the laboratory what is called a solar simulator. So that means you can exactly reproduce your results based on the solar simulator which you are using, because the outside sun will be changing depending on where, which country you are, what is the temperature, what is the cloud content, etc. So we normally use a solar simulator. If you do not use electrolytes, but you use just semiconductors, solids, then you get what is called a photovoltaic cell, which is more common with physicists. So you can have a semiconductor electrolyte, a liquid junction, which chemists work more, or you can have a photovoltaic cell also producing electricity from light. So these are different options you have to convert light into electricity. Of course, you can also convert light into fuels. A lot of people are trying to work on that, how to convert, like the plant also produces fuels. Can you convert carbon dioxide, which is to some useful chemical like methanol, ethanol, etc. So a lot of industrial applications are there for that. So going a little deeper into that, so I talked about two types of catalysis. A photocatalyst uses a semiconductor in the presence of light. The light, the photon generates electrons and holes, and the electrons and holes need to be separated such that they don't recombine. If they recombine, again, you will get luminescence. So you lose the electrons and holes. If you lose the electrons and holes, then you cannot do reduction and oxidation at the two electrodes. So you need to save your electrons and holes. So these are the key things. You need long lifetime of the electrons and holes. So these are your charge carriers. So long lifetime of your charge carriers is important. And separation of the electron from hole from each other and taking it to the right electrode is very important for doing the right oxidation and reduction, which will give you high oxygen or hydrogen at the different electrodes. If you do not have light, but you have potential, then you can use a catalyst and apply a potential, and you will have an anode and cathode, and you can then, from water, you can generate oxygen, and you can, of course, generate hydrogen also. Depending on what kind of system you have, what kind of electrode situation you have, you can create oxygen evolution or a hydrogen evolution, or you can have both. As I said, you can have a total water splitting. But here the catalyst is called an electrocatalyst, and the two electrodes are anode and cathode, and you need to apply a potential. Obviously, the given an option, if I have to use, I would like to use the photo way, because that would be cheaper. But of course, at night you cannot use photons. And so, of course, for applications where you work at night, you need electrocatalysts for doing the same reaction. So since we are talking of photocatalyst and photons, you need to know what the photon energy is. The photons we are trying to mimic is like solar photons. So you know, when the photons come, we have an atmosphere. So because the atmosphere has many things, the photons get scattered, absorbed, and many things. And these people have done studies and found out what are the photons which finally come on Earth. So if you know that, there is a term which is used, AM. AM means air mass. So we use a standard number, AM 1.5, which tells you, suppose our atmosphere is 1.5 times absorption, then what is the standard? That is the standard followed by all solar cell manufacturing companies. So you have to do your experiments with your solar simulator, which works at AM 1.5, which tells you that you are using the specifications which is followed by everybody in the world. All solar cell manufacturers, everybody in the world follows AM 1.5. That means, what is the solar radiation under that condition, and that is mimicked here. That means under that condition, you will get this kind of variation of wavelengths. And so you will see that a large number of wavelengths will follow in this range, which is like in the visible range. And that is why you want to work with visible light photons, because maximum number of photons are in the visible range. You of course have photons in the near infrared and it's close to the UV also, some photons are there, but the maximum number of photons are in the visible range. So you want to use a semiconductor which can take up these visible light photons. So your semiconductor should be able to do that. So when you design, you want to design semiconductors which can have few properties. One is maximum absorption of photons. The other is they should not get destabilized when photons come. That means they should not get photo corroded. They should be stable. They should have long lifetime. And of course, they should have allow for high lifetime of charge carriers. So these are some of the aspects you need when you design these semiconductors. And a typical semiconductor band diagram will look like that. You have a conduction band, you have a valence band, and when light falls, what you said, the electron holes are generated. So you have holes and electrons have these energies have to match with the reaction that you want to do. So for example, you want to use water to be oxidized by this hole, then you need this energy level to be at a particular place. So you need these calculations of the numbers of the conduction band edge, that means this energy level, and the valence band edge, and that will tell you what can it reduce and what can this oxidize. So for example, if you use certain catalysts, it can oxidize certain things. Other catalysts will not oxidize that. Some catalysts can oxidize, say for example, water, other will not do, because of the position of the valence band edge and the conduction band edge. So these numbers are required, and you need to know these numbers, and you can find out these numbers through electrochemical measurements. And other measurements are also there, but a simple way of finding out these edges are through electrochemical measurements. So our aim has been to kind of design semiconductors, may be made of one material, two materials, three materials, and plan their shape and size such that effective band gap is such that it absorbs maximum number of photons. Also, the effective band edge of this three-layered system or two-layered system, it may be a composite or it may be a core shell structure, should have an effective band gap which lies in the visible such that you get the best photons. So you see, typically in the solar system, UV photons are only 4%, whereas visible light photons are 43%, and that is why you want them, right? So you want to engineer heterostructures. That is what is most of the time the activity in our group, to engineer semiconductor heterostructures, which will ultimately give you high efficiency. What happens when you engineer heterostructures? So you have your material, suppose this is your semiconductor, and you have an electrolyte, I can have another semiconductor here, then there will be a junction. So you need to know, if I put one semiconductor with another semiconductor, how will this junction look like? Where will be these levels? And what kind of band gap bending will take place? So these are something which you have to calculate, and that will tell you how efficient electron or hole transfer across these interfaces will take place. So if you have an electrolyte like it is shown, then you have an interface with this semiconductor. This is one case. You may have two semiconductors with an electrolyte. So there will be then two types of interfaces, semiconductor-semiconductor interface, semiconductor-electrolyte interface. And you have to understand the energy levels so that you know where the electron will go when light shines. So when light shines on this surface, then how will the electron go to, from which material to which material? So that will be told by the band edges which you calculate. Overall, the total efficiency depends on three factors: the absorption, how many photons are being absorbed, the separation, that means how efficiently the charge carriers are separated, and how effective is the transfer of electron at the electrode. So these, if you multiply these efficiencies, you will get the overall efficiency, which will give you the efficiency of the device which you are planning. The device may be a photovoltaic device or a photoelectrochemical cell. So it may be different devices based on charge carriers. So whatever I have written here is basically what I said. You have to use a large fraction of the incident energy. You want to prevent electron hole decombination. You want to prevent back reactions on the catalyst surface. And you want a long lifetime of electron hole pairs. And the catalyst should not get degraded. So the photo corrosion should be limited. The way we make this by different methods depends on the material. If I have to make barium titanate, I will make one way. If I have to make barium sulfide, I will make some other way. If I have to make calcium phosphide, I will make some other way. So in our lab, we make all kinds of materials from oxides to sulfides to selenides to phosphates, phosphides, borides, any material, metals, alloys. We have made all kinds of materials. So typically, we use low temperature synthesis. That means your reactions are normally below 400, 500 degrees centigrade. Most of the time, it is below 200 degrees centigrade. When we are using autoclaves, autoclaves are chambers where you use and some solvent in a closed atmosphere, so there is a high pressure developed. You can calculate the pressure developed with the volume of solvent that you take, and you can plot pressure versus temperature, this plots, etc. And you can also find out at what level the solubility of the material is high. Why we use autoclaves? Because many times our starting materials are oxides. They are not soluble at 100 degree or etc. But under high pressure, they become soluble. So we use hydrothermal and solvothermal methods, right? So these are different methods. I won't go into the methods. Microemulsions is a different method where you use surfactants, etc. to make micelles or reverse micelles. These are like nanoreactors, and you can do reactions within nanoreactors so that you have controlled size of nanoparticles. All the materials that we are talking are of the size of nano-sized objects. So one of the dimensions is 10, 20, 30 nanometers. It may be a nano wire. That means the length of the wire may be 2 micron, 3 micron, 5 micron, but the diameter will be 10, 20, 30 nanometers. So all of them are nanostructured materials where one of the dimensions is in nanometer size. So this is the first example. So this is a very celebrated paper. It's very highly quoted. This was our one of the first papers where we made zinc oxide, which is a UV catalyst, convert it into a visible catalyst by making a shell with a chalcogenide. So we combined a kind of high band gap material. Zinc oxide is a high band gap material with a band gap of 3.37 electron volts, with a mid band gap semiconductor, which is cadmium sulfide, which has a band gap of 2.4 electron volts. And if you combine, this is the kind of band structure, qualitative band structure you will get. And overall, you will have a situation that when light falls, visible photons will be captured by cadmium sulfide. It is like a sensitizer, and then it transfers electrons to zinc oxide, and holes will be separated on cadmium sulfide. So the thing is this kind of geometry of a mid band gap semiconductor with a high band gap semiconductor, the way the energy levels are placed. See, the conduction band of this is higher than the conduction band of this. The valence band of this is higher than the valence band of this. This geometry is called a type 2 semiconductor. So we have type 1, type 2, type 3, different types of semiconductor band diagrams. Based on that, the transfer of charge carriers takes place. So this is a type 2 geometry, and there is something called zigzag geometry also. So those who work on semiconductor, who work on heterostructures, because why we are calling heterostructure? Because there are two materials. This is a schematic diagram that one of them is a nano rod. So zinc oxide is a nano rod, and the metal sulfide, cadmium sulfide, silver sulfide, indium sulfide, these are three cases we studied, and they form the shell. And they can be like particles on the surface, or you can have a real shell on top. If you have a shell, you have some kind of properties. If you have particles, you have different properties. And we have shown that a shell is better than have particles. So this is the way you make it. You start with a zinc salt, and you convert it into a zinc oxide nanorod. Then you functionalize with citric acid. Then the citric acid cap nanorod is added with cadmium ions, and then you add thioacetamide. Thioacetamide will convert cadmium ions to cadmium sulfide, and then this shell will grow. And so you have to optimize these conditions to get a very good shell. And you can control the shell thickness by controlling the amount of thioacetamide and the amount of cadmium ions that you add. So I'll just show quickly the diagram. This is a core shell structure. This is a low resolution TEM, and this low resolution TEM that you see is having a shell thickness of around 30 nanometers, right? And that is cadmium sulfide, whereas the core is zinc oxide. If you take high resolution TEM, you can see clearly the fringes of zinc oxide and cadmium sulfide. You can see the interface very well. So to design this structure, you have to optimize your conditions. The interface has to be very good. You should not have interdiffusion of ions. That means zinc ions should not go into cadmium sites, and cadmium ions should not go into zinc sites. So this kind of, you have to optimize the conditions. If you do that, you can see the properties. Pure zinc oxide absorbs in the ultraviolet, it's 372 nanometers. Whereas if you add the shell, it shifts the absorption to the visible region. It is now in the red region. So it's towards the red region. And now it is at 465 nanometers with 30 nanometer shell. This is the absorption spectroscopy. The property says that if the pure cadmium sulfide had very poor current, photocurrent, whereas the 30 nanometer shell has a very high current at the same voltage. So you take any voltage, 2 volts or 4 volts, the core shell structure will have a much higher photocurrent. So that is what you show. So this is one case I explained in detail. Then you can do other things. This is another case, I won't go into detail. Same thing we repeated for, instead of cadmium sulfide, indium sulfide, you can make core shell structures. You can shift the absorption. You can get very good photocatalysis. This is something is like degrading dye. So you have organic dye, you are degrading with zinc oxide, very poor. You are degrading with indium sulfide, not very good. But if you degrade with this core shell structure, you see the change in the concentration of the organic compound decreases very fast. So this is a standard procedure people have been doing. This is pure photocatalysis, okay? This is generating photocurrent. The photocurrent of the red curve is much higher. That's the core shell structure. So just what I explained earlier. So you can make very good materials with core shell structures. Now I change into something else. This is a different design because the talk is on design of nanostructures. This is a design where you have a basic material is TiO2. Again, it is a UV catalyst. As the core, it's a rod. But then instead of one shell material, you have two materials. So the choice of the material is like, one of the shell materials is a N-type semiconductor, indium sulfide. The other material is a P-type semiconductor, copper indium sulfide. When you choose N-type and P-type semiconductors, you know what will happen in physics. You study in school, you will get a NP junction. When you get a NP junction, you will have charges which will form a kind of a barrier. The charge will not flow, right? Because you have a positive and negative. So you are creating internally a positive and negative charge barrier situation, and that allows a longer lifetime of charge carriers, right? So if you have this kind of a design with a photo anode with two semiconductors on top of a semiconductor, you can not only convert from the UV photocatalyst, which is titanium dioxide, now moves into the visible, and also you have an additional factor of a p-n junction effect, which enhances the efficiency because your lifetime of charge carriers increases. So that's what I wanted to say. A very simple experiment to show that the lifetime of the charge carriers is high is to do a photoluminescence. The photoluminescence goes down this blue curve. That means electrons and holes don't recombine. So that blue curve shows that in this material which you have designed, there is very less electron hole recombination compared to the red and the black ones, which people have, which are the bare cadmium sulfide TiO2. You see they are very high photoluminescence. But this one, the designed one, has very low PL, and that means the charge carrier recombination is very low. This is another example to show if you have a good core shell structure, the left-hand TEM shows that, but this compound, this heterostructure is different. It has titanium dioxide rod. On top, you have copper sulfide. CuS is a very good material. It's a mid-gap semiconductor, and it's a nice material. Also, it is non-toxic. Normally, copper is good. So you, instead of using cadmium and all, people like to use something like copper. So copper sulfide on top of TiO2 is a core shell structure. On the right side, you have copper sulfide particles on the titanium rod. A point is which one is better. So you do a comparative study of these two materials, and you can see that the one which is core shell, the green one, has much lower photoluminescence. That means the charge recombination is much lower in the core shell structure than the composite, which shows much higher photoluminescence. So this is an example. I'm just giving you the key point in this. There are two designs, two semiconductors designed differently, giving two types of heterostructures, giving two types of efficiency. Right, this is details. If you want to study, it is there in the paper. What will the core shell structure give? It will allow this kind of band bending at the interface. But if you don't have the core shell structure, that band bending will not be possible. And so this flow of charge carriers, right, will be much more effective. This is another design I will tell you, that you can design core shell nanostructures with a particular facet. So this is another example now. So I showed you the first case was zinc oxide as a UV photocatalyst. We converted it to a visible photocatalyst. Later, I showed you titanium dioxide as a UV photocatalyst, which I converted into UV photocatalyst. So here, sodium niobate is now the UV photocatalyst. It is well known. It is also a very good material, but it's expensive. And we convert it into a visible light photocatalyst using a shell material, which is cadmium sulfide. Okay. But here our design is a little different. So here what we do is when we synthesize, we can make crystals of cube shape and octahedral morphology. So both the morphologies, and you see, depending on which morphology you choose and you put the shell material, so we get different properties. So you take the cube of sodium niobate and put cadmium sulfide, and you see and you measure the photocurrent. I just came to the property directly. The photocurrent of this material, which is the squares, which is this form of sodium niobate, which crystallizes in the cubic crystal system, that has much higher efficiency. Now the cubic crystal system actually has got this kind of polyhedras. Okay, so let me not confuse you that a cube morphology need not give you a cubic crystal system. Okay, actually the cube morphology gives you, when you take X-ray, the orthorhombic crystal system, whereas this polyhedron gives you the cubic crystal system. So morphology is different and crystal system is different. Okay, so the cubic crystal system of sodium niobate, which contains the polyhedrons, are more effective than the simple cubes which form the orthorhombic crystal system, they have lower photocurrent. Also, we can measure there, this is called the Mott-Schottky plot. From here, we measure the slopes. From the slopes, we get it is N-type or P-type. When you see this dual slope, if you have a this kind of slope, which is a positive slope, it tells you it's N-type semiconductor. When you have a negative slope, it tells you it's a P-type semiconductor. This material, that means, has both the slopes. It has both N and P-type, right? That is what it says. And that is why it has a higher efficiency, okay? Because whenever you create N-type and P-type, you create higher efficiency because of the internal charge barrier. If you measure, this is called solar to hydrogen conversion. You see the red one is much higher, the C-type sodium niobate. The stability of this is very high, okay? So I don't have too much time into going into details, but to tell you what was the difference. The difference was the morphology of the sodium niobate. Both the materials are the same. Both the core shell structures are the same, but one of them had a different morphology of the core material than the other. So why is it different? If you calculate the band structure, qualitative band structure, one of them, the one which forms in the cubic crystal system, which has the polyhedras as the core, that means it has got facets of two types of facets. Looks little bit like octahedron, but it's a polyhedron, which looks like octahedron. It has two types of facets, and it has this type two geometry, which allows you electron hole separation. The other one does not allow you electron hole separation because this is not type two geometry. You see the conduction band edge of this is above the conduction band edge of this, whereas here it is below. Here the valence band edge is below, right? And the valence band edge is below here, okay? But it is different from this. So this arrangement is different because of the morphology. So you can do some more calculation. This is the polyhedron. It has two facets. It has all the facets are same in a cube. So cubic morphology does not give any preference to electron and hole. But this one has a preference for electron and hole. And this slight difference in energy makes a difference for the electron and hole to stay in different facets. So I'll not go into further detail. That's definitely. You can also make some disordered perovskites, which has high polarization. You know, we have a lot of dielectric materials where polarization is high. So because you know that, can we make such materials useful for photoelectrochemistry? Because we know they have high dielectric constant, they will have polarization. So we made these materials and we saw that they have, you know, if you want, this is the absorption. This shows that among these two materials, one of them, this is called the time resolved photoluminescence. This shows you how fast the charge carriers are recombined, okay, in the two materials. So, but more important, you measure the current. When you measure the current, one of them shows higher photocurrent than the other, and we can explain that. So these are two materials. One is a neodymium-based compound. The other one is a hafnium-based compound, and both are perovskite-related compounds. And they have, the reason one has higher photocurrent is because it has higher polarization generated within the material. Okay, so we can, these are Mott-Schottky plots, and from this 1 by C square, C is the capacitance, you can get the charge carrier density. You can calculate the charge carrier density, and then you will see that this compound, the one with neodymium, has higher charge carrier density, and hence it has higher photoelectrochemical efficiency. So this is the band diagram. You can show that if you have a simple material under equilibrium, so there is no band bending shown here, but if you have a material where you have an interface with a semiconductor, here it is a perovskite made of hafnium, and this hafnium-based compound, oxide, which has a perovskite structure, in the presence of an electrolyte, will show this band bending. And between these two materials, the band bending is different. So you can calculate, and this shows higher band bending than this one. Not only that, it shows certain trap states within this. And because of these trap states, you have a different behavior, this becomes more efficient. Okay, so the way the semiconductor behaves due to its polarization, the way the interface behaves due to band bending, and the generation of the trap states, right, all these contribute to the neodymium compound being a better material and has a higher efficiency in this. This is a multiferrite compound. So we used the idea of the multiferrite that we know it will generate polarization internally. So we know polarization will create more charge carriers and not allow them to recombine. So we show that is true, and it enhances the photocurrent density. This is another example where we use very small gold nanoparticles in titanium oxide to shift the band gap from ultraviolet to the visible. So small amount, you know, gold nanoparticles have a surface plasmon effect. So if you make small gold nanoparticles, say 5 nanometers or 2 nanometers, 3 nanometers, so that is what is the challenge. You have to make very small gold nanoparticles and use it alongside with TiO2. We can shift the absorption to the visible. So these are the TEM pictures, and you can see that depending on the amount of gold, actually we load different amount of gold, 0.2% up till 1% of gold, and we see the maximum effect at a particular loading, and we can explain why that is there. Why at a particular loading of say around 0.7% of nanoparticles in the TiO2, it has the best electrochemical, photoelectrochemical efficiency. Okay, so this is the photoelectrochemical response. This composite of gold and TiO2, which is referred as PA5, has 0.7% of 5 nanometer gold loaded onto TiO2. And this shows the highest photocurrent. Okay, now, so this is one of the first reports on this kind of thing. Earlier people have shown on gold TiO2 photocatalysis, but not photoelectrochemical application of gold in TiO2. Okay, so this is one of the first case of that. This is again the Mott Schottky plot, and from that you can calculate the charge carrier density. And as you see, you can tell it is n-type semiconductor. And you can also calculate the dielectric constant theoretically. We can calculate how much is the dielectric constant. And in our system, we calculate it to be 57, because depending on the amount of gold is to TiO2, there is a plot. You can find out what is the dielectric constant. Using that dielectric constant, we can prove that at 0.7% loading, you get a high dielectric constant, and that is why you get a high efficiency of the gold. So not only that, we calculate what is called the flat band potential. When band bending takes place at the interface, and when charge carriers move, after they become to in equilibrium, the band is called the flat band potential, which is in line. So we can calculate that, and we can show that where the flat band potential is for this composite PA7 with respect to the Fermi level, which we calculate. So these numbers are useful in explaining charge carrier density, which you see is very high for PA7, and that is why you have very high photoelectrochemical efficiency. So these are two parameters you can calculate from the Mott Schottky diagram. Moving to another design. So how much time I have? 10 minutes? 15 minutes? How much? I think.
Yes, sir, you have.
Okay. So this is one example, very simple example. This was done. This is one of the oldest work I'm presenting. This work we did maybe same time as the first paper on zinc oxide cadmium sulfide in 2012. I think we did this work. This was done by Devashri and carried out by Manu. That we made these kind of surfaces, which were like small pockets of tantalum oxide. You know, tantalum oxide is a very interesting material, but it is expensive. It is a very good catalyst. We made these kind of materials using a slightly complicated method, solution method. And there we coated at the surface, at the top, we made these cups of silica and coated on the top tantalum oxide. Because if you make the whole thing of tantalum oxide, you will need a lot of tantalum oxide. The idea is to use the tantalum oxide only as the catalyst. The remaining thing is silica, which is very cheap. So we made silica with the rim on the at the top, only covered with tantalum oxide. So you can read this paper how this was made. And what it does is the silica absorbs the organic material which you want to degrade. So this is a photocatalyst application. You want to degrade an organic dye. The organic dye is trapped by the silica in this cup like thing, and silica is also a good adsorbent, right? We can control the pore size. This was optimized for a particular pore size where this absorption will be maximum and the photocatalytic efficiency will be maximum. Depends on the pore size that you design. So you have to optimize your conditions for the right pore size. For the perfect pore size, the maximum hydrogen that we generate out of this photocatalytic water splitting experiment is around 372 millimoles per gram or something like that, if I know the number. At that time, it was a very high number. Very few compounds were known, that too only with tantalates, which were producing by photocatalytic water splitting with tantalum oxide related compounds, right? So this was using very small amount of tantalum oxide, getting very high hydrogen generation. So I said, you have to optimize the pore size. So we got the best results when the pore size was around 19 nanometers. So we made many materials with different pore size, etc. So now I come to my last two examples. So here, in these examples, I will show you how we use cadmium sulfide as the semiconductor. It is a composite with graphene or such carbon-based materials which allow you to take away the charge carriers from the site where they are generated very fast. And we also do ultra-fast experiments with Professor Hiren Ghosh at INST Mohali, who did the ultra-fast experiments for these compounds. Doing ultra-fast experiments, what you can do is you can study the mechanism of the electron transfer and hole transfer exactly. So this material is called supraparticles of cadmium sulfide. Why are we calling them supraparticles? Because one of these balls that you observe is made of many, many small nanoparticles of cadmium sulfide, which are like 3 to 5 nanometers in size. They combine to form or assemble to form these large particles, which are called supraparticles. Each supraparticle is like 400 nanometers. Now, when you have only cadmium sulfide, you have some band diagram. When you have cadmium sulfide 400 nanometers supraparticle, you have a slightly different band diagram. And when you have that supraparticle in contact with graphene oxide or graphene, you will have a different kind of a charge transfer process. So in this first case, you are looking at charge transfer from the cadmium sulfide to the layered graphene 2D structures, which allows you efficient charge separation. And this efficient charge separation leads to the higher efficiency of the photoelectrochemical process or photocatalytic process. So this is a TM pictures, which shows 400 nanometer cadmium sulfide on a graphene surface. It's embedded on graphene, and you can do photocatalysis. So if you first do photocatalysis, that means take organic dye and look at what happens to the degradation of the dye. You will see without graphene, you will have one rate of degradation. When you put the graphene surface in touch with the supraparticles, the degradation is much faster, which tells you that the efficiency of the electron or hole which is doing the reduction or oxidation on the organic compound is much faster because the electron is able to travel to the electrode much faster. Okay, you can also do the photoluminescence, and you can see that this is the steady state photoluminescence, where you see that the photoluminescence is quenched in the presence of graphene. Okay, so the intensity is much lower in the presence of graphene. That means the recombination of electron and hole is reduced, obviously, because electrons are taken away by the graphene surface. This is time resolved PL. So in time resolved PL, you can measure exactly in this is, you see, nanosecond time scale, how fast is the green one. You can see the electron is being taken away by the graphene substrate very fast, so which you can observe in the time resolved PL data. So this green one is where you have the graphene substrate. In the blue one, you don't have that graphene substrate, only the 400 nanometer particles of them. If you take simple cadmium sulfide, not the supraparticle, it is even worse. It is the red curve. Now to look at the excited state, this is the what we call is a pump probe spectroscopy, or you say femtosecond spectroscopy, or you say ultra-fast spectroscopy. Basically, you are using lasers to excite your electrons, and then the electron is moving very fast, and you are probing it with a laser which can probe a very fast electron transfer or hole transfer. So this you can do only in an ultra-fast process, where you are using a laser to pump the electron and a laser to probe the dynamics. Okay, so what you get is the transient, these are called transient absorption plots. So I can just tell you one thing. You can look at this black and red curve. It tells you, this is called the bleach recovery. So in the bleach recovery, once you use the pump and then it system tries to come back to the ground state, so how does it recovers? So it, you will see that the red one recovers much slowly than the black one, and that is because the lifetime you have increased because of the graphene or graphene oxide two-dimensional substrate of carbon that you have. The lifetime of the charge carriers is increased, so the bleach recovery time is much larger. And these numbers we can get exactly. I'll show you. We have to model this plot using either a bi-exponential, tri-exponential, etc. And from that, you can get numbers from those exponential plots. And you can exactly tell how much time is there a fast process? Is there a slow process? Are there two processes? You can tell exactly one process is taking how many picoseconds, another process is taking how many picoseconds or nanoseconds, etc. So this is using ultra-fast spectroscopy, or it's also called transient absorption spectroscopy, where you are looking at absorption spectroscopy, but from the excited states. You cannot do with ordinary spectrometers, where you do UV visible absorption, etc. You cannot do this. You need a pump probe setup to do absorption spectroscopy at the excited state. And when you do absorption spectroscopy at the excited state, then only you can explain the real mechanism of charge transfer, electron transfer, or hole transfer in the system. So I am not going to read all this. Whatever I said, that is there. This is the other system. Again, there we had only cadmium sulfide on graphene oxide. Okay, now you have cadmium sulfide with CNT. Like graphene oxide, CNT is also going to attract the electrons. It's called an electron scavenger. But what we do, we also add a hole scavenger. So in the previous one, we had only graphene oxide, which takes up electrons. Here we have a electron scavenger and a hole scavenger. So we have two things. That means the moment light falls on cadmium sulfide, you generate electrons and holes. Electrons will be scavenged by carbon nanotubes, and holes will be scavenged by cobalt phosphate. So this is the idea and this is the design. And if you do that, then this is the work of Preeti does and got this is our recent paper in just published in 2021 in Journal of Physical Chemistry. So the ultra fast studies was done with Professor Hiren. Okay. So these are all, you can see nice pictures, TEM, and you can see these are the EDAX mapping showing you all the particle, whatever cadmium is there, sulfur is there, carbon is there, etc. And here you have got multi-walled carbon nanotubes. So you can see in these pictures, multi-walled carbon nanotubes along with the your cadmium sulfide spheres, right? And the Raman spectroscopy is what tells you clearly what kind of carbon nanotubes you have the D band and the G band of the carbon nanotubes, which you can easily see in the Raman spectra, and you can identify that. So this is the data which tells you how efficient is your design. So pure cadmium sulfide with only cobalt phosphate, cadmium sulfide with only carbon nanotube, and cadmium sulfide having carbon nanotube and cobalt phosphate both. So it is a ternary composite, which is the best. And how do we know? You measure the current density. You can also recycle. This is called chronoamperometric studies, where you cycle and you study the current as a function of time. So you switch on and switch off. Every time you do this, you will get the current. And you see in this scale, this is like going to 250 microamperes per centimeter square, right? If you want to, this is so low, the cadmium sulfide and CNT, it is so low compared to this, you can barely see. But if I zoom this, I can show you here in the inset that yes, they also have on-off profiles, but the numbers are very low, 25, whereas this one is 250. So that's the difference. And we can plot this one, this photon efficiency, this is a conversion. You can do that. What we call is ABPE. And this conversion then is really tells you that the ternary composite is really much better than the binaries and the pure compound. Okay. So I don't want to tell you more. So these studies you can do in a PEC cell with where you have a 3-electrode system and you have a appropriate light. You can use xenon lamp and you with appropriate wavelength, and you have a system to measure the photocurrent properly, etc. You plot the Mott-Schottky plots, which I have already told you. You can see that you have both in the ternary composite, you can see clear NP junctions created, and you can calculate the current density. And you see for the ternary, the charge current density is 3.15 10 to the power 22. Whereas for the others, it is of the order of 10 to the power 21. So high charge density in the ternary composite. Same thing you can do. Now this is the same transient absorption spectroscopy. That means you are looking at the excited states and looking at electron and hole transfer. And using that, you are understanding this mechanism. So electron from cadmium sulfide being transferred to CNT, holes from cadmium sulfide being transferred to cobalt phosphide, and what is the mechanism that is being followed through these bleach recovery plots, which you can follow. So I think I'm finishing my time, and I have another meeting with director and others right now regarding other things. I have to leave. So just to show you, you have to model those plots and get these multi-exponential plots. From this, you will get the data in different picoseconds. You have to look at the contribution, which one, see femtosecond contribution is there in cadmium sulfide. That means 81% is at very fast time scales in cadmium sulfide, which is not good. You need slow numbers. So if you look at this cadmium sulfide and this cobalt phosphate, this number is now 69% or something. And in the ternary, which is not here, it is even less, okay? So these model the exact transfer of electrons and holes, etc. So I will stop here. I have many other things, but I don't have time. So thank you, Tokir. I have to quickly go. If I have one or two questions, I can quickly answer. I have a meeting at 3:30. Actually, because of me, they postponed it from 3 to 3:30. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So quickly, I would like to, you know, let you know that it's always been a pleasure listening to you, and we as materials chemistry faculty always feel extremely honored to have you as in Jamia as an eminent material chemistry scientist, and we look up to you as a role model to pursue research in material chemistry. And with that, I think I should, with your permission, I would like to share with you one or two questions which the participants, actually they have posted many questions, but I'll just ask one or two from them. So the first question was, in case of heterostructures, how can one measure the band edges to know the band edge position to be able to generate the required oxygen species?
Yeah, so you can do by many methods. You can, if you are a physicist, you can do by other methods, but for chemists, actually the best method is using electrochemistry. From electrochemistry, you can get the band edges.
Then what is the correct evaluation method to calculate STH efficiency?
Oh, I can send you one paper. Actually, it's very, I can send you, there are lots of papers. If you Google, you will find out. Solar to thermal hydrogen efficiency. So
there is another, sir, a short question. Why cube-shaped structure has much higher activity?
No, it has lower, actually. Cube one, the cube system, cubic crystal system, the particles actually are not cube. They are actually like octahedron. They are polyhedrons. So polyhedron with two different types of facets. One is the 110 facet. The other is the 114 facet. So when it has two facets, each facet has different energy because different number of atoms are on each surface. Whereas cubes have same number of atoms. If you have a cube morphology, you will have the same facet. 100 of a cube will be like 001 of the cube. So there is no difference in energy. When there is no difference in energy, the electron and hole does not have any particular choice. Whereas in the other one, it has a choice. So the electron chooses the facet where it has lower energy. Hole chooses the facet where it has the lower energy. So there is a separation. And that's why that is better.
Then, sir, related to this morphology, there's a question that which parameter should be taken into account to control morphology of nanomaterials?
That is why you need to, you know, slowly lose your hair. You know, it takes a lot of experience to design and plan, do synthesis. Because synthesis is something I cannot tell you and write a book. If you do this, of course, if I do it in the lab and get the process and optimize, I can tell you. But beforehand, a priori, synthesis is something is very difficult to tell you unless you optimize conditions. Little bit you can tell if you do this, you get caught. But you have to optimize. And that is why synthesis is exciting. The world will never be old because always you will synthesize and get new materials, new size, shape. If you do some, add something new ingredient, you may get a new thing. So that's always the challenge in synthesis. And that's the beauty of synthesis. So synthetic chemists are never old because they will always find something new to do.
So one last question. I know you need to rush, but there's one last question that among all the hybrid nanostructures which you have mentioned, which one is the most efficient catalyst for photoelectrochemical studies?
Of among all, I have not compared among all. That would be 100, 200.
Needs a lot of literature.
Lots of compounds. You gave me a good idea. I will probably compare all the numbers. But some of our best catalysts are the cadmium sulfide zinc oxide is one of the good one. Then this ternary composite is very good, which I just now showed. And there is one catalyst with TiO2, which is also good. But I have to compare all the numbers. So thank you. I have to leave now because...
Thank you, sir. Thank you for joining with us and giving your valuable time, sir.
Thanks to Jamia, Vice Chancellor, Head, and Professor Tokir Ahmed for organizing this meeting. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for coming, sir. Thanks a lot. So now I thank to all the audience participants to be with us and since morning, and I hope all of you have submitted your feedback forms. Either you have opened through Cisco Webex or YouTube link. So if not, please save the link and you can submit your Google feedback form by 4:30, I think Dr. Sapan Kumar Jain or Amir Mehtab have given the time in the chat box. So I thank you all, and tomorrow we will start our session at 10. So please reassemble here at 9:45. And Professor Gangli, sir, you should be here by 9:45 tomorrow, 9:45:50.
Yeah, I'm trying to join the other link. So, yeah, I'll join.
No, I will send you the link, sir. I will send you the link tomorrow. Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah. So you have to appear two times tomorrow, sir. Morning and the evening, sir.
Yeah. I will leave now.
Yeah. Okay, sir. Bye. Bye, sir. So tomorrow we will meet at 9:45. So Dr. Ufana or Dr. Sapan, do you have any announcement for the participants?
I think we'll be sharing the Google form, feedback form. That
it is already
is
shared in Webex chat box as well as YouTube chat box. It is already shared, and
you can tell them the time.
Participants are already submitted.
Okay.
And if those who have not submitted, they actually they can submit by 4:30. Before
4:30 will be the deadline.
Yes. And all the lectures are very good. As you know, the quality of lectures and the quality of the speakers, you can see here. And tomorrow we will have the wonderful lecture. The first lecture will be delivered by Professor Mao, then Professor Arun Chattopadhyay from IIT Guwahati, then Professor A.K. Tyagi, and in the last, Professor K.V. Ramanujacharya will speak on the different issues of the energy, nanomaterials, and the nanostructures. So with these words, I am closing the today's session here, and thank you so much for your patient listening, and have a nice day.